Thank you for being with us again today. What a wonderful privilege. And of course, the title for today is the Day of the Vow, an Afrikaans gelofte dag. Maar kom ons bid saam. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for all that you have done. And Father, coming to a day like today, we need to understand what the vow meant. Otherwise, we will never be able to know what the day means. So we honor you and we praise you now as we come before you. Father, I come and ask that you will just clear our hearts and our minds. You help us to take off all filters that we normally filter these type of things through. Take out politics, take out all these things. And let us just speak about you and your word. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. What is the day of the vow? Back in the days, it has been called Dingaan's Day, as well as the Day of Blood River. And now, under the new government, it has been called the Day of Reconciliation. But whatever we call it, it started with a vow. Allow me a brief summary of our South African history. And I'm going to concentrate on the vow afterwards, because that is what I want or need to speak to you about. It's not about the politics. The year 1838 was the most difficult period for the voortrekkers since they left the Cape Colony till the end of the Great Trek. They faced many difficulties and much bloodshed before they found freedom and a safe homeland in their Republic of Natalia, today's KwaZulu-Natal. This was only achieved after defeating the Zulu King Dingaan, or Dingaan, at the greatest battle ever fought in South Africa, namely the Battle of Blood River, which took place on Sunday, the 16th of December 1838. The battle was fought between 464 foot trekkers, or pioneers as it will be known overseas, led by Andries Pretorius, and an estimated 10 to 15,000 Zulu warriors on the bank of the Nkomi River. This followed only months after the Zulu leader Dingaan went back on his word to Piet Retief and murdered Piet Retief and the men with him. After killing Piet Retief and about 100 people of his delegation, the Zulu king went on and his impis killed the remaining voortrekkers who were camped at Doornkop, Bloukrans, Moordspruit, Rensburgspruit and other sites along the Bushman River. In Zulu, the Bushman River means Ntsezi, in the present province of KwaZulu-Natal, near the town of Vienen. Not a soul was spared. Old men, women, babies were murdered in the most brutal manner, and this became known as the Vienen Massacre. Andries Pretorius consulted with a man in his group by the name of Sarel Silhier. Sarel Silhier was known as a devout Christian, and he wanted Silhier to lead the pioneers in a prayer promising God certain things should he save their lives and give them victory in this very, very coming battle that was on the verge to happen. But Sarel Silhier was skeptical. At first, he feared that the people may not keep their promise to God and that will bring them more sorrow in the future. There was never a doubt in Silhier's mind that God can give them the victory. In the end, they got people together and they made a vow along the following lines to God. I'm reading a translated version now in English. He says, "We stand here before the holy God of heaven and earth to make a vow to him that if he will protect us and give our enemy into our hand, we shall keep this day and date every year as a day of thanksgiving, like a Sabbath, and that we shall build a house to his honor wherever it should please him, and that we will also tell our children that they should share in that with us in memory for future generations. For the honor of his name will be glorified by giving him the fame and the honor for victory." Of course, God came through for them, and casualties amounted to over 3,000 of King Dingaan's soldiers that were killed, including two Zulu princes competing with Prince Mpandi for the Zulu throne. Three Foot Jacket commando members were likely wounded, including Pretorius. Then on 13 December 1880, the people were facing great trials again, as Great Britain has just taken over the old ZIR, and they threatened to annihilate them as well. They gathered on the farm Paardekraal of M.W. Pretorius, who was the first president of the ZIR. He wrote the first constitution and is also considered the founder of the old Pretoria. They came before God on Sunday the 12th of December with Reverend Nicholas van Warmelo of the Dutch Reformed Church, who led the service. They acknowledged that the people forgot their promise to God at Blood River. This is the importance and the important part now, just as Silhier has feared. On the 13th, they all gathered and made what is known as the Paardekraal vow to God. Present was also President Paul Kruger. Part of the promise was that they will from then on keep the original vow made before the Battle of Blood River. And they will keep that vow, and they will include it in the current vow should God protect them from the Brits. There were 6,000 people present, and they also erected a stone pillar there as a memorial. After four battles, the outcome was found to be in favor of the Boer nation. It is remarkable how politics have highlighted the events of Blood River and its vow above the latter Paardekraal one, which actually affirmed the first. God never chooses between black and white, just as he did not take sides between the ZIR and Great Britain. He faithfully answered the prayers of those who called on him for protection. The old ox wagons had a chest in front called a varkist. The varkist wagon chest, whatever you want to call it, was a place where they stored all the precious valuables, of which the family Bible was one that were normally put in there. God protected his word. That was what he protected. His word that says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. His word that call on us and tell us that we can call on him in our times of need. But the thing that God protected most was his word that was carried on. You must understand that God protected his word, as many missionaries at that stage have been praying for a breakthrough to minister to the proud Zulu people who relied only on their ancestors and brute strength. It also paved the way for Zulu Prince Mpande to overthrow Dingaan and lead the Zulu people in a time of relative peace. I want to step off the political struggle now to look at the spiritual side, because that is what it's really about. This is why the Day of the Vow is significant. There are Christians in our country today that says that I cannot be expected to keep the vow, as I was not there. To such I have a very simple reply. I hope you do not confess as a Christian that Abram's blessings are also yours, because as far as I know you weren't with Abram either. May we look at a few scriptures that show us how God looked at a vow. Deuteronomy 23, verse 21. When thou shalt vow a vow unto the Lord thy God, thou shalt not slack to pay it, for the Lord thy God will surely require it of thee, and it would be sin in thee. But if thou shalt forbear to vow, it shall be no sin in thee. That which is gone out of thy lips, thou shalt keep and perform, even a free will offering, according as thou hast vowed unto the Lord thy God, which thou hast promised with thy mouth. Then let us go to Psalm 50, verse 14. Offer unto God thanksgiving, and pay thy vows unto the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Ecclesiastes 5, verse 3. For a dream cometh through the multitude of business, and a fool's voice is known by multitudes of words. When thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, For he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. Better is it that thou shouldest not vow, that thou shouldest vow and not pay. Jonah 2, verse 7. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto me in thine holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice unto thee with a voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. And lastly, Matthew 12, verse 36. But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So the question is really one that was a warning from Sarosel here back in the days. He says, I don't want this vow. For the simple and plain reason, if the people do not keep the vow, if they turn back to their promise, on their promise to God, worse things will happen. I don't need to tell any of you what you read in the news every single day. What I am doing is to say that we as children of God, I'm not talking about heathen, I'm not talking about atheists, I'm not talking about people that do their own thing anyhow. I'm talking to everyone that professes that he or she is a child of God. You cannot say that Abram's blessings are yours, because that's what the Bible says. It was because of a covenant, because of a vow. And today we are standing and we've got a vow. And even if it is just me and my house, but we should bring this into remembrance. We should say, Lord, I repent of all the days that I've went against this. Because that victory led to victory not only for the white people, but for the Zulu nation, but for us as a country. That victory freed us back in the days from the attacks of the people from Great Britain. And today we can stand as a country free from colonialism, free from everything from the outside. We can stand. And that is why it is so important that we will not now take on another yoke. People, Paul came to the Galatians and says, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? He literally said to them, you just were set free and now you go in under another yoke again. Why will we come out under all the yokes and now go under a yoke of Marx, a system and Marxism and all these things? And communism and no, we need to be a free people under God. All I've done is today, is I've informed you, you must decide. Because you are going to stand before God for what you have decided to do with the day of the vow. Let us pray. Father, I want to thank you that in Blood River and Pader Kraal, you showed one thing. That you are a God that listens and answers prayer. That is all. Father, whoever called on you, that will be the one that you save. The one who trusts in you. And Father, this morning I want to say, Lord, we are so used to giving our word and going back on it. I repent of that. I say, Father, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for what our country has done. I'm sorry for our country, Lord, that you've taken to such high heights and that we've went back on our word. And today we are literally in the dumps. Not reckoned by anyone. Laughed at by the world. Frowned at by the world. Yes, Lord, we suffer today under an ungodly government. Because that is the government we deserve. As we repent, will you change us around again, and that the country of South Africa, all races, races without faces, or faces without races, that we will stand up and be accounted for again. I honor you, I praise you, and I worship you, and I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. May you make the right choice today. God bless you.
So full.